Welcome into Scoops with Danny Mac on Fox 2. I'm Dan McLaughlin. Tonight, it's a look back at the life and legacy of Bob Plager. I'll visit with a former St. Louis Blue that knew him very well, and that's Jamie Rivers. It was an incredible celebration of life for Bobby. Jamie was there, and we'll talk it over with the former Blues defenseman. He's headed for baseball immortality, and that's Larry Walker, the former Cardinal that finished his career in St. Louis. A chance to catch up with the newest member of baseball's Hall of Fame is later in the show. And as far as the current Cardinals go, John Nogowski is making a name for himself with the club. He had a remarkable spring to force his way onto the Cardinals roster, and he's in the big leagues now. We'll catch up with the 28-year-old rookie in just a moment. The Cardinals' homestand continues tomorrow night at Busch Stadium as the Redbirds will play host to the Phillies. The giveaways will be the Jack Buck statue and the Lou Brock Bob Gibson lapel pin. Seats are still available at cardinals.com/promotions. Let's bring in John Nogowski of the St. Louis Cardinals. And first and foremost, before we get into anything, John, you're a great story. Congratulations on making it to the big leagues last year and again making the team out of spring this year.
Thank you very much. Yeah, it was a heck of a spring. It's been a heck of a journey. So many people have played such a role in it. And to be able to make those calls on, you know, before opening day and on my way to Cincinnati was pretty special.
Who were those calls to, if you don't mind pulling back the curtain a little bit?
Yeah, my girlfriend, my parents, you know, just some of my best friends that I've grown up with that, you know, they've been along this journey with me this whole time, from high school ball to growing up in the yard, playing together, guys that I, you know, lived with kind of all through college and through the minor leagues and stuff. So, you know, I kind of a whole crew, really, that's kind of had your back. It's a whole support system. And, you know, some of the most emotional ones were my girlfriend and my parents. You know, they've sacrificed so much of their time, their money, you know, everything. It was definitely an emotional 48 hours. And then, you know, it was opening day and it was go time.
How did you not give up as a guy that was drafted, then had to go back to independent baseball, and now you're in the big leagues? How did you not just say, you know what, I've had a good run, I'm done, I'm going to move on to the next stage of my life? How did you do that?
Yeah, you know, I think the biggest thing for me, you know, some people have asked me that, and it was never really even, it was never even on the table. Like, it was never an option for me. I think that I kind of had always put up good numbers in the minor leagues, even, you know, before I had gotten released. And it was more of just kind of a numbers game as far as how many first basemen they had, where they got drafted, you know, how much money a team had invested in guys that were ahead of me. And, you know, for guys like you that kind of understand this game, it's a business. And, you know, a lot of these guys that they draft in the early rounds, they get more opportunities because they've got more money invested in them. And it just took the right team with the right opportunities. And, you know, it's a team that kind of values you for what your skill set is, not necessarily what the status quo is for first baseman or corner outfield guys. You know, a high average, high on base, you know, hit my home runs, driving a ton of runs, not a huge strikeout guy, which is a little bit different from kind of what most of those corner outfielders are, or first baseman and or third baseman this day and age. So, yeah, I guess the reason why I never really gave up was because I felt like I always had good success. It was just kind of the wrong opportunity at the wrong time, and I knew I just needed a shot.
How did you learn to put the ball in play so well? You are the anti, and I mean this in the best of ways, the anti 2021 baseball player, where it's many times the three outcomes, strikeout, walk, home run. You put a premium, though, on putting the ball in play or drawing a walk, getting hit by a pitch, and you value it. How did you learn that and that approach going at the plate?
I think I'm just competitive. I hate letting the pitchers get me out, you know, and much less a strikeout, because I feel like he really got me if he struck me out. I don't like getting hit by pitches. right there. Zach Pop got me pretty good from the Marlins. So that's still a little gimpy, but yeah, I mean, any way that I can get on, whether that's a hit or a walk, whatever it may be, that's value to the team. That's how you score runs. You know, solo home runs are great, but three-run home runs are better. And it might take a walk and a hit-by-pitch, or it might take a walk and a single to hit the three-run home run to get on for Goldie or Nolan or, you know, Yachty or whoever it may be that day, Paul. So for me, it's just kind of like, whatever way I can not get out, I'm adding value to my game. And, you know, over the course of 500 at bats, 100 games, that just is kind of added up. And, you know, I don't like going out of the zone. I hate chasing pitches. So I, you know, I put a pretty big emphasis in that in my training of making sure I don't go out of the zone, whether that's batting practice or front flips or whatever it may be. I try to always take the pitches that are out of the zone and try to lock in when I'm working. So, I think it boils down to just being competitive and not letting them beat you.
How about Goldie? You mentioned him and you're watching Arenado. You get the chance to watch Yachty go into the Hall of Fame. What do you pick up from that trio of guys, when you watch them and their preparation and how they play the game?
How much time you got, Danny?
Yeah,
it is something to where I make sure that I am on the first bus every day getting there before those guys, because I almost want to get my work done so that I have time to watch them, to see how they go about their business. Goldie, I'm picking Goldie's brain every day. He's probably sick of me by now, but just ask him about relievers that he's seen, what his thought process is on these certain situations. You know, and it's the same with Nolan. I mean, that guy's always talking hitting. You hear about it, and then to get to see it on a daily basis, to get to see Yachty's, you know, preparation and his focus day in and day out, catching every single day. I mean, really, it's incredible. And you know, the stuff that you read, the stuff that you hear about, it is 100% true. These guys are incredible.
I'll wrap it up with this. Opening day for John Nogowski, who had been through so much to get to this point. What was opening day in St. Louis like for you?
Oh, it was so special. I had my whole family there. And, you know, I've watched that on TV for, I mean, I don't know how long, as long as I've been watching baseball. And, you know, just the sense of pride that you had that you're one of these 26 guys that get to do this and get to enjoy this. I mean, it was truly, truly special. And the fans are absolutely incredible. Ballpark's absolutely incredible. And it is absolutely the most special opening day in the big leagues. So to be able to do that was, I mean, it's tough to put into words. Happy I didn't tear up driving around the field.
It's awesome seeing you in the big leagues. You have earned it, and make it a long, long ride in St. Louis. It's fun to watch you play, and thanks for doing this.
Thank you, Danny. Anytime, man.
You got it. That's John Nogowski. A look at the life and legacy of Bob Plager is coming up. Scoops with Danny Mac is brought to you by Schnucks, Lou Fuse, Royal Banks of Missouri, and Ryan Kelly, the home loan expert.
Most people know my grandpa as a tough, gritty hockey player, but I know him as Coach. He was truly the best grandpa, whether he was taking me to hockey practice at 7 a.m. or taking me to Hooters on my 5th birthday. We always had a good time.
But I've heard people refer to Brett Hull as the Mickey Mantle of the St. Louis Blues. And it's very easy to say that if Hully's the Mickey Mantle of the Blues, then Bobby Plager is most definitely the Babe Ruth of hockey in this town.
In life, how often do we get to be in the presence of a giant? How often do we get to rub shoulders with someone that was responsible for so much? Someone that impacted so many lives. When I reflected on what to say, I wonder how many skates have been laced, jerseys have been bought, and spirits have been lifted because of him. Bobby was the rarest of men. He was a man that carried a city and a franchise on his back, yet never noticed the weight.
The incredible celebration of Bob Plager's life at Scott Trade Center just a little over a week ago, as fans, former players, and team personnel gathered to say goodbye and celebrate the life of Bob Plager. Jamie Rivers, the former Blues defenseman, was there, and it was incredible. Jamie, what was it like from your perspective?
It's a unique experience, right? Because, look, Bobby was so near and dear to all of us, and it was just amazing to be able to celebrate Bobby. That's what he wanted. You know, Bobby always talked about that when people pass away, we always all get together because, you know, we mourn that person. And Bobby always said it's a shame. All the alumni guys come in and all the family members and the best friends and people you know. He said in his honor, he wanted a party. He wanted a party. And we had the ability to do that on Saturday night. Of course, we've had all the other events as well. But the party, the Bobby Plager party, was Saturday night at Centene Community Ice Center, which they did a fantastic job. But it brought all of the old characters back into the same room. I mean, we had Holly, we had Chaser, we had Twister, we had Butchie. Gretz was there, Reed Lowe, Tom Tilley. I mean, the list goes on and on and on of guys that showed up. And we didn't let Bobby down. We had a party. I mean, so much so that like 2 days later, I'm still dragging from it. And I think the purpose of it all was for Bobby to be looking down and smiling, saying, look, I got the boys back together for one last party. And it was in his honor. And I just feel like it was the right thing for Bobby. He would have loved it.
Why do you think he connected so well with the players? The players loved him so much. The proof is how many players came back to celebrate his life. What was it about Bobby?
Bobby was exactly what you see is what you get with Bobby. There was no polish at all. And if he didn't like something you did, he told you. If he liked something you did, he told you. And he was always there. He represented the logo at all times. And he never, ever liked anybody taking a cheap shot at the St. Louis Blues. If you put that jersey on, you respected it. You bled for that jersey. And that's why, you know, people respect that. And Bobby was such a great team guy. Like, how often, think about it. How often do you have somebody who's not a Hall of Famer that ends up representing your franchise as the face of your franchise in a city like St. Louis? And he's from Canada. But it's what he did in the community. He stuck around and he built this franchise from not just a player, but every job title under the umbrella of the St. Louis Blues, except owner Bobby Plager, is had next to his name. And it says a lot. Walk into any establishment in the city, walk into any rink in the city, and ask somebody for a Bobby Plager story. They've got it. Whether it's a joke, whether it's a one-liner, whether it's at a party, whether it's just talking to kids in the hockey rink, Bobby was always there.
Well, what would be your story when you think of Bobby Plager?
Well, Bobby is, you know, for me, it was funny because I met him on my first day at Brentwood Ice Rink, my very first training camp. And look, I knew of Bobby Plager, but I'd never met him. And here comes this guy strolling in with a coffee in his hand, and I'm watching him work the room. And it's just like, every guy he went to, he had a little side snicker, and guys would laugh. And I'm like, who the heck is this guy? Like, I know he's not the coach. And he came around, and he came over and introduced himself to me, the young kid. And then he was telling me about a story about he was scouting me. And he used to just leave after the second period. And I was like, why would you do that? Like, what, did you not like the way I played? He's like, no, I usually had about 5 points by then. I knew I could get to the bar nice and early. And so I would laugh, and then finally, you know, the guys tell me, look, that's Bobby Plager. He's one of the original guys here. He's part of the foundation of this hockey club. And from that moment on, I just love Bobby. Everything about it. You go walk around the Enterprise Center. Bobby knew everybody.
And finally, what do you think will be his legacy when people look back at Bobby Plager?
Well, I think his legacy, quite honestly, is that he helped build this franchise. Without Bobby Plager in St. Louis as one of the original Blues coming in here, like, can you imagine? This franchise may not be where it's at today. And so Bobby Plager's legacy, quite honestly, is the guys that he left behind here in St. Louis to do the job for him. There's about 40 or 50 guys left here in town right now, and we keep adding to that because it's amazing here. But it's going to take every single one of us to be able to fulfill the needs that Bobby Plager has left behind. And we take it very, very seriously.
Thanks, Jamie. Really appreciate it.
Anytime, buddy.
Coming up, we'll switch gears and visit with Larry Walker. The former Cardinal is headed to the Hall of Fame, and that's next on Fox 2. Scoops with Danny Mac is brought to you by Blue Tail Medical Group, Royal Banks of Missouri, Hair Saloon for Men, and Triad Bank. Let's bring in the newest member of Major League Baseball's Hall of Fame. It's been put off at least 1 year, but we hope to get to Cooperstown this upcoming summer. That's one of my all-time favorites, former Cardinal, and Larry Walker is with us. Hey, Larry, great to see you. How are things going?
Great, Danny. How you doing?
I'm doing well. How has life changed? It was about this time last year that you got the call to go to the Hall of Fame. You haven't had the ceremony yet. It is going to come. It's going to happen. But how has life changed since you got the call that you now are in Major League Baseball's Hall of Fame?
Well, I don't want to say a whole heck of a lot because not much has happened. I think we've all been locked in our homes for the last year. So, you know, life has carried on as normal for me. And I guess until the ceremony, which apparently is going to happen this year, no matter what, whether it's live in Cooperstown or via what we're doing right now. So it's going to happen. So we'll see what how things are in July, I guess.
Have you thought about the speech? I mean, is it on your mind like every single day about what you want to say and make sure that you do the right things with that speech?
You got no idea, buddy. I'm a mess with that. You know, part of me, I hate to say this, part of me hopes that it doesn't happen live in Cooperstown where there might be 90,000 people there because I have sleepless nights over it. I haven't even started writing anything yet that at least that's gone on for more than maybe 50 words. I keep starting over because I really just don't know. You know, there's so much I want to say and then so little I want to say because I don't want to be up there too long and start rambling on and stumbling over my words. But like I say, it's the honor itself is probably bigger than my worries about how the speech goes. So I'm just going to try to thank the right people and keep my composure.
You had the chance to go, though, and walk through Cooperstown, kind of like the private tour, if you will. What were your emotions like in seeing those plaques and realizing that you're going to be a part of that?
Well, you know, fortunately with the Cardinals, we had a fantasy camp, as you remember, in Cooperstown a couple of years before that. So I was able to get a tour basically through the similar places I went to as a Hall of Famer tour. So to compare the two was quite incredible for me. The one where I was just at fantasy camp, I walked through and I was in awe at everything. And then you walk down, you look at the plaques and you see everything. And this one was kind of similar, but a major difference in the fact that TV cameras were following me everywhere. And at the end of the yellow brick road was a place on the wall for me to sign where my plaque was going. So two similar tours with completely different endings to them.
It's incredible. What has this meant to the people in Canada, being a guy from Canada? You grew up wanting maybe to be a hockey player, and it takes you now to baseball's Hall of Fame. What does it mean for the people in Canada?
Well, like I said, I've been locked in, so I'm not sure exactly what all is going on up there. But from the reactions I can see online and from friends and family back north of the border, they're quite ecstatic about it. So, you know, I guess that's the other part of it. Even though as nervous as I am about going to Cooperstown and doing the speech live, I put myself on the other side, how many people might be coming down from north of the border, which I hope is a lot, and waving their Canadian flags proudly. A big moment for me, but even a bigger moment for Canada to have their second person into the Hall of Fame.
It's incredible, and it's also incredible that you got the chance to finish your career in St. Louis. And as you reflect on that and that short amount of time, what comes to mind for Larry Walker when you think about wearing the birds on the bat?
Well, talk about one of the greatest teams in baseball history. You know, I think everybody can probably name five teams that really stand out and mean the most to them and their families growing up and, you know, the World Series championships. And I know we've talked about it a lot. You know, my first at bat in a St. Louis Cardinal uniform where I struck out and got a standing ovation. For me, that spoke volumes about the fans of St. Louis. You know, as a visitor going there for many years, as all visitors do going there, you leave each game going, wow, what an amazing crowd base that this place has. These guys are lucky to play here and wear that uniform. I got to experience that.
Larry, I'll wrap it up with this. You had a long wait to get to the Hall of Fame. Kind of a two-parter here. Was it worth the wait? And secondly, what are you most proud of as you reflect on your career, which was now taking you to the Hall of Fame?
Well, I guess the wait, the one thing that stands out, if I wouldn't have waited 10 years, I wouldn't have been the 333rd person into the Hall of Fame. And everybody knows my three is my favorite number. So I tripled that by waiting 10 years. So that was huge. And, as you know, like I say, I guess it's the road and the people along the way that got me to the Hall of Fame. You know, when I started playing, I didn't know the rules of baseball. I didn't know what a slider was or a forkball was. I had to go to winter ball, and I went to five instructional leagues to try to learn how to play the game. So it's a great story for kids that are maybe thinking they aren't good enough or haven't got the playing time in to maybe make it to the major leagues one day, or just professional ball for that matter. It's a grind, but it can be done. I grew up playing 15 games of baseball a summer till I was 16 years old. So baseball really wasn't in my genes until I was 16, and then I really took it on seriously. So it's something that can happen later in life to a lot of kids who aspire to maybe making it one day.
Hey, it's great to catch up with you, Larry. Congratulations again. Can't wait to see you in Cooperstown coming up, and I'm sure we'll see you at the ballpark very soon.
You bet. Thanks, Dan. I appreciate it.
For Larry Walker, Jamie Rivers, and John Nogowski, this has been Scoops with Danny Mac on Fox 2. A reminder, we do this every Sunday at 10:30, and I'll see you next weekend.